Continuing our program this afternoon, I am absolutely delighted with this next group of panelists. It's an incredibly illustrious group of professionals in our industry who are all going to be talking on something that I hope is important to everyone in this room, and that's making high-resolution audio more accessible to mainstream America and the world. And our moderator today is Marc Finer, and Marc is the Senior Director of the Digital Entertainment Group. So take it away, Marc.
Thank you, Maureen. Good afternoon, everyone. Okay, so before we begin with this great panel, let's do a little level setting. In order to understand why we need to make high-res audio more accessible, we have to tell you a little bit about why high-res audio came to be. I think as most of you know, the digital music revolution began well over a decade ago in what was largely driven by convenience. But since that time, based on a lot of hard work and effort from technologists, carriers, platform companies, and the music industry, we now can deliver not just CD quality, but much better than CD quality sound digitally, whether for music downloads, and even, coming in the future, streaming. So to do this, we had to concentrate on bringing together the key people in the industry through associations like the Consumer Electronics Association, the Recording Academy, and of course, the DEG. And the DEG is the digital entertainment group that I represent. And the DEG has in its working group for high-res audio, as you can see from the slide, some of the leading representatives of every major music label. And they've come together to put the roadmap in place to drive high-res audio to bring this new concept and experience to consumers. So, in doing so, we had to do a few things first to set the table. To begin with, we had to start to define what high-res audio is. And I'm pleased to say that just about a week or so ago, the DEG in cooperation with the CEA, the Recording Academy, and of course the major music companies all reached an agreement on a baseline definition for high-res audio. And also, as a separate but equally important act, we've put together descriptors to explain master quality recordings and the differences for both the music retailers and, of course, the consumers. One of the other things we're doing is trying to convey and evangelize the experience of high-res. So let me just do a quick sample. Was anyone at our Jungle City Studios event last night? Let me see some hands here. We had nearly 200 people jammed into this great studio, listening to some of the greatest recording engineers and producers in the industry, all about high-res audio and the various music genres available to support this. So with that type of support, along with all the CE companies, and of course their retail partners, this has the potential to be a very, very important development for all of us. So today, we have a great panel of people to tell you more information about what high-res audio is all about and where it's also going in the future. So let me introduce them very briefly. To my immediate left is Jim Belcher. Jim is a VP of Technology and Production for Universal Music Group's Global Business Division. Jim's a 15-year veteran with UMG. His team evaluates all of their emerging technologies, identifying the new business opportunities on behalf of the company's very expansive roster of artists. To Jim's left is Howie Singer. Howie is Senior VP and the Chief Technology Strategist at Warner Music Group. And he's responsible for analyzing all their businesses and the potential music service models that'll drive their existing businesses going forth. And during the 90s, Howie also co-founded A2B, a music pioneering digital distribution service that used audio and security technologies developed by AT&T. To Howie's left is Maureen Droney. Maureen is the Senior Executive Director for the Producers and Engineers Wing of the Recording Academy. That's the Grammys, folks. And she began her career in recording as an assistant at a very famous studio called Automat in San Francisco. Maureen went on to do projects for George Benson, Whitney Houston, Santana, among many other artists. To Maureen's left is Aaron Levine. Aaron serves as Senior Product Manager for Sony Electronics Home Audio Division. Aaron has over 15 years of experience in the CE space. He specializes in product marketing, communications, and new business development. And prior to Sony, Aaron worked for Pioneer Electronics. Then To the left of Aaron is Paul Wasek. Paul is the National Marketing and Product Planning Manager for Onkyo USA. He's a 30-year veteran of the CE industry. He's worked for a number of companies, Panasonic, Samsung, Sony, Sirius, among others, and he's worked in a number of key product marketing and management roles. And last but not least, we have John Jackson. John is VP of A&R and content development for Sony Music's Legacy Recordings. John oversees the audio and video content for the entire Legacy Group. He's worked there for 16 years, and under his watch, he's managed a catalog of numerous artists, AC/DC, Johnny Cash, Elvis Presley, Billy Joel, Willie Nelson, the list goes on and on. So thanks all of you for being here today. But since it's CE Week, I want to start with the first group, which is the consumer electronics companies. And I want to start with Paul with a question. Onkyo, in your exhibits here on the floor and last night at Jungle City, you're focusing your high-res product efforts on the AV receiver category. And I'm wondering, because AV receivers are a cornerstone of home theater, how are the consumers who are buying your receivers reacted to your high-res offerings on your products? No mic? Here we go. Here's another one, Paul. Let's try this one. Good.
Are we gone?
You're on.
There we go. Good. Thank you. Well, we've been supporting high-res audio on our products for the past three generations, and it's actually been received quite well. We've been constantly making improvements to it and making sure that, you know, the latest formats are that we can play them through, whether it's through streaming, through the internet connections, or through the USB. So overall, I think it's slowly being accepted, but more and more people are now becoming aware of what high-res is. I think a lot of the younger people are beginning to listen to music again and beginning to hear the difference between what maybe they grew up with and right. what they've been on their MP3 player through their earbuds and what really is out there. So I think in general, it's something that's happening slowly, but it's being appreciated more and more.
All right. And we'll come back to younger people in a few minutes. Aaron, at Sony, in contrast to just an AV receiver category, your company's offering a range of products. What's the strategy behind this in terms of engaging different types of product customers for high-res audio?
Well, it's all about the lifestyle. And I think just like the music that's being consumed by our consumers, you know, there's different places, different types of music listening, everything from the audiophile grade, file player, as well as, you know, your basic AV receiver or your, you know, two-channel stereo system that you'd have in your office. And I think that the more we can engage in different lifestyle orientations when it comes to high-res music, the more acceptance it is. It's, you know, some customers aren't going to be an AV receiver customer. Some customers aren't going to be audiophile, but they might be a wireless speaker customer. Or they might be a headphone customer. And as long as we can touch upon as many different areas of audio products and be able to support music how customers want to listen to it or where they want to listen to it, I think it's a really cool experience and a lot of fun for them to enjoy in their environment.
All right, good. We'll come back to the products in a moment, but I want to turn now to the music companies. And Jim, in general terms, you've seen from Universal standpoint the launch of high-res files, you have licensees. So far, what has the company's expectations been in terms of both sales and response to the products you're offering through your licenses?
Well, a few years ago, we had no high-res retailers at all, so there was no revenue generated by high-res. We licensed one retailer a couple of years ago, and we didn't really have any expectations of the market. We wanted to see what happened. And for that first year, that retailer exceeded our expectations in a big way. We thought that, well, okay, well, there's a market here. People really, really dig high-res audio. So now we have three retailers online. Two of them were just licensed within the last year or so, and are starting to sort of ramp up the offerings that they have. And it's still very early, so we don't have any predictions of how they're going to do, but we're very encouraged.
Great. And Howie, Warner Music, of course, has been in the forefront as well. From your standpoint, what has been the reaction from your licensees and your customers?
I think our experience has been the same as Jim. Several retailers out there with download services, limited catalog, although we keep adding to that catalog as we prepare more content in high resolution, but relative to the size of the catalog they have, they're good performers. And you know, I think that we expect the numbers to be better this year for those retailers, both because more stores and more revenues per store.
Right, so progressing with this. And John, you're the king of catalog up here with the reissues group at Sony Legacy. What has been the response from the standpoint of Hi-Rez on the catalog offerings at Sony?
Well, I think that it's been overwhelmingly positive. I mean, the Sony had a bit of a head start because we had the SACD format that started in the late 90s that the company was very much behind. And, you know, those DSD files that were created are still kind of the high watermark in terms of, you know, just sort of amount of information coming from the analog. So we've been able to, you know, have a head start using those. We also started several years ago with using Hi-Rez as an archiving initiative, you know, to understanding that, you know, tapes from the 40s, 50s, 60s are starting to, you know, fall apart a little bit. So really from a preservation perspective, we started looking at Hi-Rez as a you know, an archiving measure, which now can be sold in these through these various formats. But I think overall it's been very anyone that hears it is like, well, duh.
From the difference, right.
You know, but it's a matter of now going back and redoing a lot of the digitization that was done for CD and for other formats and, you know, starting over with the Miles Davis catalog and starting over with the Bob Dylan catalog, et cetera, et cetera.
We'll come back to some of the challenges you face in doing that in a moment. But we've talked about the CE space, the music company's business perspective, but without creatives, with artists, producers, and engineers working on this, none of this happens. So Maureen, you're with the Recording Academy. The producers and engineers are your family. And in terms of how they go about doing their job, their workflow process, what is it exactly that Hi-Rez Audio brings in terms of challenges for tools and software? And how is this affecting their work in terms of the efficiency of their workflow?
Well, there's kind of two different versions of that. The people who were at our event last night are people who've been working in Hi-Rez a long time. They're huge advocates for it. They know the difference. They can hear the difference. They always have. And they find it hard to believe that everybody isn't recording Hi-Rez. But when we take a survey of our kind of middle class, the Recording Academy has chapters all around the country, and we have producers and engineers groups in all of them. So we recently took a survey to find out if they were recording in Hi-Rez, and if not, why not?
Right.
And there's some real considerations that there have been in the past more than now, and people just haven't kind of moved on as technology's moved on. So things like storage used to be more complicated, less bandwidth to make transfers with. If they're dealing with zillions of tracks, as pop music sometimes
right.
does, it can be more difficult for them. And some of them, interestingly, even people who work with superstars who travel internationally may end up in a chateau studio in France that's using older software. So those were the issues that they have dealt with in recent years. And also, I think there's a bit of chicken and the egg with it that's really starting to change because they didn't know why they should make the extra effort when they didn't know where it was going to go and what was going to happen with it. So starting to see all these outlets is really exciting for
right.
people. So I think a lot of those challenges are being addressed as people move up to newer software and are sort of all upgrading as they do anyway into software that makes it a lot easier to handle.
So for the audience perspective, all these elements have to come together seamlessly. And one of the things we're trying to do in this process is not just enhance the listening experience, but the overall user experience. I wanted to ask Howie, since he works on the development front, the popular use of metadata to enhancing digital delivery across various platforms and content. Is there special things needed for Hi-Rez Audio, or what steps are we looking at to try to bring metadata improvements to the music chain?
Yeah, I really don't think there's much special when it comes to Hi-Rez Audio. We all need to do a better job, regardless of the service
right.
that we're talking about, in terms of metadata, including producers, engineers, artists in the metadata over time. It's how we deliver everything digitally to every service around the world. And so, you know, now that we have established definitions, it wouldn't surprise me to start to see some of that percolate in, but I wouldn't say there's something different about the need to do better metadata for these offerings than for what we already have. It's already a challenge for every one of the companies and all our partners in the distribution channel just to do a better and better job.
Expand with the scope of what you're doing to embrace high res.
That's something that's really starting to change too, as people see that we're dealing with, that metadata is important everywhere and all of the things that they do to get paid and have things flow through the system, so.
Okay, so Jim, you referenced a few minutes ago some of your licensees and retail partners, the specialty ones that many people in the room know, HD tracks, of course, acoustic sounds, et cetera. But I think a question is on everybody's mind in terms of where this is going, and without disclosing any details, which of course you can't talk about here today, have any of the major retailers and subscription services expressed any interest in high-res audio at this point?
Formally, no. I'm sure it is on their radars as the market starts to develop, but certain things have to happen first before subscription partners can get involved with high-res. One of the things that has to happen is that high-res chipsets have to work their way down to portable devices like phones. When that happens, when high-res chipsets are ubiquitous in phones or in a large majority of phones, then you're going to see subscription services be more interested in that because a lot of their users use it on phones. We already have high-res hardware available for computers, but that's kind of fading as a consumption device for music, right. And portable is going. Is picking up the slack on that. So, yes, they are interested. They haven't requested anything formally. It's on their radar, but certain things have to happen in the marketplace before that really develops.
So seeing the trend will help drive their interest more. And Howie, you were going to add to that?
I think it's really important when we talk about making high-res accessible to focus on what's the majority of the experience for listening to and enjoying music today. And the retailers that we have been, to date, focused on the audiophile market.
Right.
And they have a particular way they like to listen to music. The fact that there's some hurdles to get over to get it to them have not represented an obstacle for them. But for the average consumer, as Jim said, they listen on their mobile device. HD Tracks was showing last night at Jungle City, an HTC phone that played high resolution natively in the phone.
Right.
That's one of the steps that we need to have happen. So we need to find a way to make it easier for those music lovers beyond the audiophile segment that's existed. In terms of the services, I mean, it's not a service that's well known here, in part because it's not present in the US market, but everybody's heard of Spotify around the world, started in the Nordics and Sweden. They have a competitor that's named Vimp. W-I-M-P, so we would say WIMP here in the U.S. That may be part of the reason they're not in the market here yet.
And they're also not here today either for that reason.
Yeah. But they have a, quote, hi-fi service that's a lossless streaming service already. Not at high res, but lossless. The networks there are better. They're finding good uptake. So, you know, we are already seeing services start to try and differentiate themselves on quality in places where streaming is more prevalent. And certainly in the Nordics, streaming is the main source of revenue for the music business already.
So there's opportunities here moving ahead if we can get more deployment of devices and more services following.
Yeah, I just wanted to add that as bandwidth starts to go down in the future, that's going to also be a big driver.
So delivery, of course, is critical as well. So we've talked about high res. We have definitions now explaining simply what it is. But we also know that there's a great file format legacy issue with many, many different formats out there in terms of coding systems, WAV, FLAC, et cetera. And I want to talk to Aaron and Paul about that. From the incompatibility story that plagued the CE manufacturers in the past, how are you addressing this type of issue now in your latest products, all these formats that are available and exist in terms of music files?
Well, I think it's pretty easy. We looked at it a lot differently. We've known that there's various ways to get high-res or listen to high-res as well as different formats and resolutions involved in it. And so instead of looking at a particular one and saying this is where you need to be, it's all about all the formats. It's about everything above CD quality. You know, and quite honestly, like, we don't dictate how the music's being recorded or how it's being produced or how it, you know, what the choices from the labels are being made. We want to make sure that we give customers, you know, every opportunity to listen to their favorite artists no matter what they're being recorded in or you know, style or format, and being able to play it back at the best possible quality pot, you know, that's available.
And Paul?
Yeah, I would agree. You know, we're making changes on every product line that we're bringing out to be able to support different formats. So this year, for example, is the first time that in our receiver line that we're supporting double DSD. Last year, it was single DSD. So as the new formats, you know, become available, we want to be able to support them as best we can. And, you know, we'll add that into our product planning as we can. But, you know, as Aaron said, we're not controlling what content is available out there in what format. So we almost have to be able to support right. anything that's right. available.
So we're minimizing the confusion step by step. We're taking some of the issues of potential incompatibility away from the equation because the products are supporting virtually everything in the latest generation of offerings. But going back on the music side now, we still have to find ways of bringing both new recordings and reissues to market and communicate to Maureen's community, producers and engineers, and of course the label A&R and marketing people. So John, you mentioned before the catalog issue from your perspective at Sony Music Legacy. In terms of locating and archiving these great recordings that have been, you know, made generations ago, how do you go about this process, and what kind of challenges is that posed from a standpoint of getting the product to market?
Well, we have a great physical archive and a great physical archive system, so we can put our hands on tapes, you know, kind of whenever necessary. Our, you know, sort of issue in this space has been that every, you know, we started with, you know, 2496 as like I said earlier, as an archiving tool, right. And you know, now with 24192 or 24384 or DSD, it's like you know, we've found ourselves having to go back and redo work you know, a couple of different times as this evolves, and who knows where we'll be 5 years from now. You know, as storage capacity goes up, bandwidth goes up, you know, it's like people could want something totally different. So we have to kind of keep that in mind as we're working. And, you know, during the CD era, we got to about 20 to 25% of the catalog, you know, from a volume perspective. Sony Music owns about 2 million tracks and about 66,000 album masters at last count. So, you know, during the CD era, we probably got to about 15, 20,000 original albums, let's say, on CD. And, you know, having to go back and redo all that stuff. And then meanwhile, on the other end, you've got your streaming services who are like, well, why don't you have all 66,000 albums available? Like, you know, and we're going, well, because we have to do Kind of Blue again. You know, so it's that's the kind of, you know, state we're in now where it's like the number of formats in the playing field is so big at this right. point that...
But I was going to ask you, one thing we talked about outside before the panel, you just finished a Johnny Cash reissue project, which goes back to analog, and that came out of nowhere. I mean, that was something that was never released in the CD era, to my knowledge, and how did that all come about, and how was it transferred specifically?
Well, that's you know, some part of the job at Legacy is to be overturning these stones of things that, you know, either didn't come out or were overlooked, or you know, a live show that got recorded and no one ever did anything with it or whatever. And so as part of the investigation process, you know, we came across these Johnny Cash recordings, which has been part of an archiving exercise after he passed away with his son, John Carter. And you know, I think to Maureen's point earlier, the fact is that these days we're just working in high res all the time.
So they went right to high res.
Exactly, so analog, multi-tracks to high res, you know, so that all the rough mixing, all the final mixing, the delivery, everything happened at high res. So it's, you know, I think that the technology now is there to just work that way from start to finish on a new project.
Right.
You know, but that doesn't speak to the, you know, vast amounts of stuff that's been done before.
Right. Okay, so we're talking reissues on one hand, but we also have new recordings. And best practices involved at the music companies, working, your A&R people, with producers and engineers. So how are you making certain that the artists are delivering the best quality product to your licensees and ultimately the consumer? Jim, you want to start that?
So since Hi-Rez sort of jumped on the radar a few years ago, we've revisited our deliverables right. for artists, and we are in the process of revising those to make sure that we hopefully will get something that is better than CD quality. It's a big company, Universal, and we have lots of opcos all over the world. We have lots of labels that function as sort of independent units, so that's a challenge to get everybody on the same page and to explain why delivering a product in high res is beneficial and takes advantage of a new market. The catalog guys, they get it. They understand what the situation is in for high res in the catalog market. They do almost everything in high res these days. The new releases are where the challenge is, getting those producers and those artists and those engineers to understand that they can participate in this high-res market if they go ahead and deliver a master.
And Howie, I'm similar at Warner?
It is similar, but one thing worth mentioning, although not a high-res initiative per se, mastered for iTunes, which is something that the biggest music retailer in the world has been promoting. The input to their process to master things for iTunes is a high-res file. So there's an incentive to be part of that program to prepare your material at high-res. Now, iTunes is not selling it at high-res today, but the fact that the biggest retailer wants incoming product prepared that way has helped to make some progress
in that
area.
And to clarify for the audience who may not have been aware of this, there have been hundreds, thousands of recordings that have been delivered to Apple for the iTunes program that have been mastered in high-res? Something on that nature? Do we have any rough idea?
I don't know a number. Do you need?
I can't speak of a number, but it's certainly hundreds, if
not more.
Yeah, I don't know.
But this has all been going on in the process.
Yeah. Well, it's a good motivator for labels and artists to do stuff in high res because they do get some marketing from Apple on it, so there's an incentive there, and that's what we're trying to do. We're trying to incentivize people to support high res.
And we'll see what happens down the road with them based on that program. So, Maureen, this brings it back into the definition and clarifying what this is from a standpoint of deliverables from the music companies to the producers and engineers. And I'm wondering, at the Recording Academy, how do your members generally approach the so-called minimum production standard when it comes to high-res? Is it somewhat wide, or is there particular de facto standards like a 9624 that they look at first, or is it varied?
I'm not sure of the question.
The standpoint is, in terms of high-resolution projects that they collaborate on with their artists, is there a preferred format, or is it seems pretty much wide open?
It's pretty much 9624, but there are other people who really believe in 192. And as you said, Mastered for iTunes has made a difference. That's something we actually worked with them on developing. As people who know what it is, it's really a set of best practices for what you deliver and not overloading the inputs of your of your machines, so that has really provided incentive for people. And the archival is such a great argument, because if people aren't sure why they're doing a high-res master, a 9624 master, a really good argument is you owe your artist the best that you can give them for what they're going to need down the line. So even if you hadn't seen, so these things are all working together. Mastered for iTunes, we have a website called QualitySoundMatters.com. that tries to explain both to professionals and consumers in sort of a lighthearted way, if you can believe it, what the different formats are and how, you know, what kind of equipment is out now that works with things, trying to move this along as well. So there's a lot working together to make it happen.
All right, so thus far we talked about what's going on the music side in the terms of the business and the workflow and the production and engineering issues. And of course, we heard from Paul and Aaron on some of the device issues current in market. But I want to go a little further. I want to try to take a look at this as to where we're heading. And I also want to bring it back to marketing and how we're going to go about and get everyone aligned on marketing messages. So I think my first question is, we talked a little bit about experience before. We did that last night in Jungle City. The retail conundrum. How do we bring high-res audio experientially to consumers through retailers, knowing the challenges we currently face? And I want to start with the CE guys, because you have to do this every day of your life, regardless of what you're selling product-wise. Don't be shy.
It's a challenge. There is absolutely no question, and we talk about it with the retailers very frequently about how do we do this, and it's a matter of content. You know, how are they going to benefit from the content, how the content is being delivered, and a lot of the products, unfortunately, that we're involved in with the with receivers and such. Aren't necessarily being live in a lot of retail outlets. So, you know, there are a lot of challenges to do it. But it's important because no one's going to take your word for it that this sounds better. They have to hear that it sounds better. You have to be able to deliver that. So it's a challenge that we just have to continue to address with the retailers and come up with some solutions that either listening parties or whatever it might be to the consumer, not necessarily to the retailer, but making sure that the consumers could come in and listen and do A/B testing and hearing samples and things of that nature.
Aaron?
Yeah, we've done a coordinated effort with our specialty channel, focusing on where we can really demonstrate, the high-res experience properly. And at the same time, we're educating our retailers, because a lot of them are still unfamiliar with what the benefits are. And as we get to enjoy the demonstration and the overall experience and the excitement that the buyers are seeing behind this, they're also starting to realize that high-res is a tool to help the consumer really step up and see why a higher quality level of, whether it's a headphone or whether it's a pair of speakers, that value equation, it's not just a low resolution file being experienced, it's a full resolution. And with that, the speakers, the headphones, the product really comes to life, and you get this big stage, and it becomes an experience where you're more engaged. And we're hoping to continue to explore how do we can execute that. And right now we're exploring headphone executions with some of the high-res players that we're bringing to market, at the very easy way to get in. And it's doing great for to increase the visibility of and how good our headphones actually do sound with the content. And as we can roll it out, and like Paul said, there are certain areas in audio where there is no power, there is no way to demonstrate. But we're continuing to educate and say, okay, this is an opportunity for consumers to be really engaged at retail, not just with the product, but with the music itself.
And I think the portable product, in particular, the mobile devices, Howie referenced it as well, Jim did. If we're going back to the millennials and even the younger customers, we have to reach them in their space, and that's how they access and enjoy music. So we have to find ways of bringing that experience around.
Absolutely,
as well.
And that's why we've looked at it as a company as, this is a lifestyle. And so we're looking at a wide selection of products in order to incorporate this kind of experience within multiple, lifestyles, whether it's in a bedroom listening, whether it's in your main living room and in a really big, as we continue to explore, portability and other venues to listen to music, it's really important to be able to, give that full artist experience. Right. These things that the labor of love that the artists and the labels are releasing, it's, to give it true justice to the consumer.
I think the other thing is that, as we try to educate the retailers and the consumers, is that we all have to speak in the same voice, in one voice, and talk about this as high-res audio. If we use different terminology and we explain it different ways, then the retailers become confused, the consumers become confused, and confusion just means they're going to shut down, and they won't accept it. So as industries, we need to work together to determine, and certainly defining what high-res audio is a great first step. But use of logos, use of terminology, things of that nature, that when someone looks at it and says this is a high-res audio file or this is a high-res receiver, or a high-res audio player, whatever it might be, they understand what that means at one time. It doesn't have different meanings.
And for the benefit of the audience, the CEA Audio Division Board that the Recording Academy participates on, the DEG works with them, and of course members up here, all are involved. We're trying to align that messaging, those descriptors, and also focus on that retail experience. It will take some time, but I think it's been encouraging thus far in a short period of time how we've gone.
I wanted to add something. Although we certainly have Maureen here representing a big part of the creative community that makes the recordings, we don't have any artists up here. And we've sort of left them out of the equation. And if you go look at the Pono website, Neil Young Project for a High Resolution Player, you see testimonials from artists who have experienced it, who have, they've been listening on their iPads and on their mobile phones as well. They hear what they record in the studio, they know what that is, and then it sort of disappears. And, one of the things that Neil Young did was have the artists listen to those high-res recordings on a prototype of his device and say what they thought of it. And we really need the artists themselves speaking to their fans to make that connection.
I was gonna say, Holly, that's a great transition. So to engage end users, first and foremost, it's the music they want. And the artist, of course, if they're conveying this, that it's important, makes everybody's job a lot easier to get them into high res. One other thing I wanted to mention real briefly before we open up to our audience for some questions. There was an announcement this morning going back to lifestyle integration by Sharp about working with the new wireless standards to extend high-res distribution throughout the home using core components. So as another business area to make the high-res experience more popular and more lifestyle flexible, that should be another good opportunity for the manufacturers. Don't you guys agree?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, the more the better. I mean, I think it's a, you know, every opportunity you can give consumers a chance to experience their favorite artists in full resolution, it's better. And you look at you know, consistency and usability across the line. And it's not about a particular format. It's about better than CD quality and as much of it as we can possibly do at the best possible quality and really have that relationship back with the artist again.
Okay. So in aligning our messages, my last question for each one of you real quickly. If we were to take one factor and address this as part of a total system of how to bring the benefits and the experience of high-res to music enthusiasts, to each of you, what would that be, Jim? First, what area do you think is most critical from your perspective?
From consumers?
Consumer perspective, yeah.
Well, I've been actually encouraged at the sort of elevation of the headphone in the last few years. When phones first came out, they had earbuds that cost a couple of bucks and they sounded pretty bad. And there's been a focus lately in the last couple of years on quality headphones, and a lot of CE manufacturers have come out with lines of headphones that really speak to getting the best out of the music. That coupled with high-res chipsets appearing in phones and other portable devices and the prices going downward a bit will encourage a lot of people to experiment with high-res. So the hardware is getting in place. Next is the software ecosystem right. has to get in place.
Okay. Howie, your key factor.
I think it's got to be convenience. If there's one thing that's driven the digital music marketplace over the past 10 years, it's that it's been easy for the average consumer to get to do it. And we've got to make high-resolution audio fall in that same camp.
They won't go backwards. Yeah.
They won't go backwards and give up that convenience that they've become used to. The files are bigger. That makes delivery slower. The networks are faster. There's lots of factors there, but we need to find a way to fit into that lifestyle that people already have for the larger group of consumers, the music lovers beyond the audiophiles, and make it easy for them to understand, to experience, to obtain, and to enjoy.
That's great. Maureen, from your point.
I think there's two things. One is absolutely experiencing it, because there is some research that shows people really can hear the difference. So giving them opportunities to do that. We actually have a presentation that Andrew Sheps is a Grammy-winning engineer who has been taking around the country, this presentation called Lost in Translation, where it's a very funny presentation that explains how your brain works with lossless and lossy and how it actually is filling in the gaps that are there. And then he plays music in different formats, and he calls it the head bob test, because he counts, you know, how many people's heads are bobbing for different resolution. I know that's not the research I'm talking about. That's just anecdotal, but so they can hear the difference. So when they have the chance to do it, and the other thing goes back to that 2011 CEA research about consumers that said consumers do want better quality audio. They just don't know what it is right now. They don't know what to ask for. So that speaks to these definitions and all of the things that all of these people here are doing to make it easier.
So the experience and getting them to the experience so they know what it is.
Yeah.
Aaron, a factor.
Well, I think it's, you know, it's that experience, it's the education, and it's accessibility. I think that, you know, part of the, you know, the convenience of what Howie was talking about, it's very similar. It's like, where are these touch points that they're buying music? Where are these touch points that they're listening to music? And as we looked at it as an overall, you know, business and category, what can we do for consumers to make it easy? What can we do from not only to help, you know, use the content, but where would they experience it? You know, is it on a phone? I mean, you know, we know that that's definitely a trend of where people are listening to music. We know that headphones are hugely important in that kind of environment and the portability. And then we also know that the best possible quality sound is in the home, whether it's coming from an AV receiver or an individual component that supports it. I think it's all these factors, but you know, predominantly it's that education and the experience is really going to help people.
And fit the lifestyle as well.
Yeah, and fit that lifestyle across the line.
Okay,
so.
Paul.
I'm going to say two. Okay.
Sure.
First, I think I had said earlier, I think it's consistency of message, that we're all saying the same thing. We're all having the same education going out to the consumer so that they understand, not only the consumer, but the dealers, retailers as well. But the other thing is that we talk a lot about, you know, the way people are listening to music. It's very personal, but music is communal. Music festivals, you know, people don't go to music festivals to put their headphones on and watch the band, right? It's, you want to be able to experience that music. If you have it yourself on your portable device, that's great. How do I get that?
Make it more social, in other words.
And it's not a social experience. So I think those are two things.
That's great. And John, I'll give you the last word on it.
Yeah, I think it's just that standardization. I think once we figure out what it is that we're making, you know, then a lot of the other stuff that's going to make it a rich experience for the consumer will fall in line, including, you know, the metadata, the artwork, the, you know, just all the stuff that we can give to them as a package. But if we're, if we keep chasing all these different formats to try and fit into, then it's, you know, we will never get to those other things.
So concentrate on the bigger message and focus.
Exactly. And then having the catalog prepared to give to people once they're like, oh, I get this high-res audio. How much is there of it? You know.
We have time for a couple questions from the audience. Gentleman in the back who I can't see. Can you stand up, please? Go ahead. There's a definition that was developed in concert with the music companies, the Recording Academy, the DEG, and the Consumer Electronics Association. And very simply put, high-res audio is any lossless audio, uncompressed audio, that is better than CD sound quality in terms of the sampling and bit depth. And that takes into account all the various file formats, coding systems, et cetera. Sure. That's one qualifying. Yes. So high-res as a category, of course, could be both physical and digital in nature. What we're talking about, of course, is a movement to align messaging and business models to reach younger digital-centric consumers and anyone else who's into the digital downloading and streaming experience. But Jim, you know a great deal about the marketplace in Europe.
Yes.
Where pure audio Blu-ray came about. Do you want to clarify for everybody?
Yes. So in the U.S., according to the latest IFPI numbers from 2013, digital represents about 60% of the revenue for the music industry. It's different in different countries, particularly in France, Germany, and Japan. There's a much greater reliance on physical media. And in those particular areas, pure audio does okay. But in the US, that is moving quickly to an all-digital ecosystem, it doesn't do as well. It's hard to distribute. This country is very big, and we've been through that path before with distributing high-res audio with DVD audio and SACD. So we think for the future for high-res audio, as far as growth goes, is in the U.S. in digital.
Okay. One last question, Rebecca. So a mix of formats in terms of coding, resolutions, et cetera, is that what you're asking?
Well, it's easy to do that, I believe, with PCM. DSD files may be more difficult because I'm not really sure of the DSD landscape for software players out there. It's probably very few. But I believe you could probably do that in iTunes already with PCM files. Well, I think you can put them into iTunes. Yeah. iTunes will accept them as PCM files.
I mean, the world of services in general has a lot of silos, right? If I'm a user of Spotify and I send a Spotify link to Jim and he uses Deezer, which is a big service in Europe, and he clicks on the link, nothing happens. So we already have that issue that consumers are frustrated when they want to share music from one service to another. There's a bunch of startups that are trying to solve that problem, and others at my company are trying to solve it. So there is this issue of there's lots and lots of silos that consumers really are not interested in you know, necessarily conforming to, as they want to share music with their friends. And it's a problem we have to solve, not just for high res, but for all the variety of services that are in the market.
But aren't most of the devices that are being made,
I was just gonna say,
circumventing that problem by playing,
which is what we talked about.
So someone should
exactly. We already have on our hardware today the ability for you to create your own playlist, both with our HAPZ1ES as well as the HAPS1, and even the software players. You can create, you know, whatever playlist you would like in whatever formats. We're format agnostic. It's all about enjoying everything better than CD and,
right,
and how you would want to do it. And so the hardware can already do it to support whatever you would need.
Which is so huge. I'm glad we made that point.
Exactly. So if you get one of these new devices that are more universal in nature, or it's ubiquitous, Rebecca, you can find a variety of ways to enjoy those files. Thank you all for your attention, and please join me in thanking our panelists.